I've given a couple of speeches lately, and I tend to focus on the kids that I'm working with. And then everybody asks, you know, how did I wind up in a tribal village, especially for 4.5 years? So I'm going to start with that. Six years ago, I moved, you know, here to India with the intention of staying for a single year. And after a year, I decided I would, you know, stay for a little bit longer. And then I thought I'll do a three-month kind of adventure in Jharkhand. And it's especially adventurous because I think a lot of people don't even know where Jharkhand is, a lot of Indian people. I say I live in Ranchi, and they say, what is that, in Bihar? And then I say, no, it's in Jharkhand. Then some people say, where is Jharkhand? I say, it's where MS Dhoni is from. And they say, oh, yes, of course. So I'm going to first share this journey of how I got out to this place, and then talk about what I learned. And the major thing that I learned, that if any of you are going to get into social work or social entrepreneurship, is that I thought working with men and women was the same, but actually it's much different. You get a lot bigger effect working with girls. So this is the girl effect. My little clicker doesn't work, though. Oh, there it is. It's in reverse. What I knew about Jharkhand before I came to Jharkhand was what I read in Lonely Planet. As any good tourist does, we consult our Lonely Planet. What I read was that there are 1,344 pages in Lonely Planet. There are 2 pages on Jharkhand, and it's actually lumped in with Bihar. And it says there's widespread government corruption, sporadic intercaste warfare, banditry, Naxalite violence, all of which contribute to the region being the poorest, least literate, most lawless region in India. So I thought, this sounds like a fun place to go. So I traded in my suit and tie for something more like this, something a little bit more comfortable. I traded in the car and driver for a Royal Enfield, and then traded in my residence at the Gymkhana Club, where the NGO I had gone to work for had put me up, and decided to move into a mud house in a village, lived with a bachelor farmer. And this in the middle here is a rock musician from Ranchi. I couldn't get anybody from the NGO to leave the NGO office, so he was the only one who decided to come out and help me. We started doing some surveys. This is where I lived, the interior lighting on the right. Some of my cohabitants from the village. Something that I noticed right away living in a village was that life for girls and boys was quite different. While boys would play, girls would work. So you see boys kind of sitting around a lot of times playing, enjoying themselves, and girls were always doing something like this, or something like this. But what was interesting was that although a lot of girls would drop out of school early, I noticed that when they were in school, in an English class I started teaching, they were actually oftentimes the best students. So when my friends and I made a merit-based scholarship from our own pocket, and 7 of the top 10 students were girls, but many of the others, you know, had dropped out. So after this little adventure, I decided to go back to New York and took a job with my favorite professor and moved into, you know, an apartment and enjoyed the city. But I got this, you know, sort of this pull to come back to India, where I thought that what I was doing in New York wasn't really that important. The city was interesting, but the work wasn't really fulfilling. It wasn't really all that fun. So I decided to come back. And then when I came back, a couple of the students said that they wanted to play football. So we decided to make I never played football myself. I played ice hockey. I played a lot of sports on snow because I'm from a cold place. And we decided we'd make a tournament for boys and for girls. The interesting thing was over 100 girls showed up for the tournament, and not a single boy showed up the next day except for the organizers. And then we asked why, and they said because, you know, there were no prizes. There was no goat, there was no money, there was no, you know, kind of toy or whatever for the boys to win. So we said, okay, we're going to focus on girls. And besides, you know, take a look at them. They're much cuter than the boys. And not that these aren't some strapping young lads, though. And the girl effect that I noticed was threefold. The first strength that the girls really had was commitment. Immediately, they really committed themselves, you know, to each other and to the program. They started coming to the field in the summertime at 4:30 in the morning. Now, all of India is on the same time zone. I don't know what the time the sun comes up here, probably pretty early, but in Jharkhand, the sun is not up at 4:30. So I'd have to switch on the headlight on my motorcycle just to get there, but they were already there. This is them stretching around 5 in the morning. They started coming from miles around, mostly on foot, barefoot. Some of them got pretty creative, got their hands on, you know, their dad's or brother's motorcycle. And then more and more girls started coming. They came in droves. And then some boys started coming back because they felt like they were missing out on something. And so we would ask the girls and the boys the same, you know, question. So this is the evidence of their commitment. We'd ask them, number one, how often do you want to play? The girls would say, every day. Number two, what do you need to play? The girls would say, a ball, a place to play, a coach. And we'd say, okay, how are you going to get that stuff? The girls said, we'll save for it. And then the boys who were, you know, kind of around in the periphery said, no, we don't want to miss out either. We want to play. And we say, okay, when? They say, well, we're not sure because, you know, there might be something else going on or nothing, or we might just not want to come. But if you go to the field, you know, we might come. And we say, okay, what do you need? What do you need to play? And they would say, everything we saw Cristiano Ronaldo wearing on TV to start. And then if you say, okay, number three, what? How are you going to get that stuff? They look at you like it's a trick question. Optiji, right? You'll give it, right? That's how things work around here. So this effect of how committed these girls were is sort of evident in this clip here, which I'm going to show. Is the sound on?
Stronger, they'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. When I get older, I will be stronger, they'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. And then it goes back, and then it goes back, and then it goes back. Oh. Born to a throne, stronger than Rome, a violent prone, poor people's own, but it's my own.
Powerful peer support system that came out of this, and the girls started to really lift each other up, to be alert to things that oftentimes, you know, make a girl fall through the cracks. you know, checking on you know, each other's illnesses, on their dropouts, on potential child marriages, which happens a lot. They became really strong groups of little girls. And for instance, this girl, she would have been married by now if not for being part of this program. Her mom said that she was getting a little bit tall. So you've heard of marriage age. This is marriage height. But she's actually going to be one of our best coaches. We'll come back to her a little bit later. This girl, her father was shot and killed in some kind of botched robbery attempt. She also would have kind of fallen through the cracks as a school dropout, but now she's gotten into a private school on a 50% scholarship. She's coaching, she's helping us build a program in Bombay. And what I learned is that, what I learned from this commitment of the girls was that you don't really want to stifle it. There's a tendency for us to end up discouraging the strength by trying to give away too much stuff too quickly. So I learned the hard way, don't do that. The second thing, second major part of this girl effect that I saw was the girls, unlike we boys, girls oftentimes reinvest what it is that they learn and what it is that they receive. This girl, for instance, Kusum, she was a school dropout, really smart, and now she's actually a topper at a private school in her grade. Now, she had to come back a couple of grades because she hadn't been very well prepared. But she's at the top of her class, and if you go to her house at night, I've taken some people, you know, by there to visit. Oftentimes, she's over at somebody else's house teaching girls who are even poorer than her, and she's done all that by, you know, without electricity, by the light of a kerosene lamp. So what she gets, she gives back. Now, statistically, that's true as well. That if we invest in women, or if women earn money, they end up reinvesting 90% of what they earn in their families, whereas we men don't do that. 35% is about as good as we do. The effect of this is that we've got girls coming together, coaching each other. We've got girls like Kusum running our Nike Game Changers Center. We're the first winners in India of Nike Game Changers. And then the thing that I learned in doing this, somewhat like not giving away, you know, too much, but trying to build on their own strengths, is that sometimes taking the time in the first place, for me that's, you know, 4 or 5 years, sometimes taking the time is the real shortcut in the long term. Now, the third strength of these girls was the multiplying effect. I learned that when you educate a girl, everything changes. And in their own words, they're going to talk about that a little bit.
We are in my house. My mom. Football jati hai. Uske baad kaam
karte
hai ya football club hai, jisme football sikhaye jaate hain. Football ke dwara bahut si cheeze sikhayi jati hai. Usme hum logo ko padhai.
I play in Yuwa because it is not like government. Government don't understand us, but Yuwa understand. Yuwa is good for us.
बहुत से मैचेस जीत के आए हैं और वे उनमें बहुत सी कॉन्फिडेंस है. वे आगे बहुत कुछ कर सकते हैं.
Before I join Yuwa, I have only 5-6 friends, but then when I join Yuwa, I have 50-60 friends. Girls, they don't play in Yuwa. They forget them opportunity, and they have a boring life. And Who's girls join Yuwa? We have fun. We saw that in public in Jharkhand, in India, that I am the best and we are the best.
So back to these two from my first English class. Talk about the multiplying effect here. Nita and Shivani have both gotten into the Indian national camp. They've both gotten into private schools. Their mothers are both completely literate. They, you know, sign everything with a thumbprint. Anita's at the top of her class, so now she's actually on 100% scholarship at a private school. She also, even though she's only 13 years old now, is one of our Khan Academy trainers. Those of you who watch a lot of TED Talks probably know what that is. It's essentially our education program where we're running science and math videos on tablets. And so this little girl on the left, Shivani, preferred to kind of hang out with animals. Not huge on school, but she can still, you know, whiz through a Dr. Seuss book. She's quite good. This is them now, last year, right before going to the Indian National Camp. Here's Shivani on the right at school. Here she is last year. Now, her father, unlike a lot of fathers, her father was actually really supportive, but he ended up dying last year. But before he died, he told her that he thought she was going to make it onto the Indian national team, and she did. And she actually flew down to Sri Lanka, represented this country. Many of you probably don't follow adolescent girls' football, but your country is actually the South Asia champions, largely thanks to this girl. Who I might add is probably the only player on that team who's actually of the correct age. Here she is with her family minus her father. The second evidence here, Neelam, this girl who escaped early marriage. On the outside, it might look like she kind of lives in the same conditions, carries heavy stuff, lives in a mud house still. But she's become probably our best young coach. She built up this program in Dharavi in Bombay, so she moved all the way from Jharkhand to Bombay, stayed there for 3 months, and is doing a phenomenal job there. This girl too, Mina, father was killed, same thing. Here she is at Bhaichung Bhutia football schools, working in Bombay. The community is now getting involved. Something that was very counterculture is now part of their social fabric. Everybody comes to watch it. People hanging out of trees, if you can see that, just to see the little girls playing football. So the girls have got tons of ownership in this. Here they are helping to build the Nike Center. And I think that the final learning here, and this isn't from me, is that I hear, I forget, I see, I remember, I do, I understand. So if you want to do something in terms of social work or social entrepreneurship, remember that. You know, don't do it for them, help them to do it. And then for yourself, if you're going to live in a village or live in a slum, whatever it is, endurance, a sense of humor, a little bit of resilience will probably take you very far, maybe on a great adventure. Your country is full of great adventures, I assure you. So good luck. And as you pass out of this incredible institution, I wish you all the best, and thank you very much for having me.